Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and His grace. I can hear the rush of angel wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you. What a beautiful morning this morning, and welcome to worship at Our Savior Lutheran Church in Nokomis. A welcome to our members, any visitors we may have in the congregation. A special welcome to those of us that are homebound joining us via our YouTube channel. Friendly reminder to please silence your cell phones. Our annual Palm Sunday Omelette Brunch is back Sunday, March 24th. After the 10 a.m. service, it's only $10. Pam has already been collecting. I know a lot of you have paid already, and the list is getting quite lengthy, so looks like it's going to be a great breakfast, thanks to Michael. Easter Lily order forms are in the lobby also. They are $15 each this year. Please consider purchasing one or more to help beautify the sanctuary on Easter Sunday. You'll be able to take your plant home after service on that Sunday. Holy Week reminder, this year, Maundy, Thursday, and Good Friday services will be held at 4 p.m. So just kind of keep that in the back of your mind if you're planning on attending Maundy, Thursday, and Holy Friday services. 4 p.m. Also a reminder about Bible study. We presently have 13, 14 people usually coming to Pastor Donna's Bible study. It's every Thursday at noon, and we are currently studying Genesis chapters 35 and 36. Please join us. Also, the Good Samaritan funds needs replenished. It's something that we've kept in this church for quite some time. You would be surprised how many homeless show up at our church looking for a prayer, a little bit of good news, usually a little bit of food, and possibly some clean clothes. We're in the process of getting some storage containers to have a change of clothes for some of those that come. A gentleman showed up here the other day. It was very quite sad. Interesting story, though. He asked for food and a change of clothes. We did not have a change of clothes at that time, and I showed him the refrigerator, offered him anything that he needed in the refrigerator. He did not ask for money. All he needed was food. He was starving. And sad story, but the beautiful ending of this is after I'd handed him this food and he was getting ready to leave, he turned around and he said, "Do you mind if I say a prayer for you in this church?" And it was just the most beautiful thing I've ever heard. So keep that in mind. Anything would be welcome in regards to the Good Samaritan Fund, whether it be public gift cards, cash, or a check. Please put them in an envelope, mark them the Good Sam Fund, and it's a discretionary fund for Pastor Donna and myself, so thank you. Remember to pick up a sheet on the table in the narthex that lists all upcoming events, and my announcements will also be out there, so you don't have to try to remember all the dates. One more thing, a little update on Pastor David. I had a great conversation with him yesterday. Pastor David Wagner, for those of you that are new here, was our previous pastor. He's fighting cancer. He's doing better. He was in a lot better mood yesterday, spoke well. He seemed very comfortable with what's going on. He's going in for once a month immunotherapy treatments. And his blood counts are good at this time. So please continue to keep Pastor David in your prayers if you would. Any other announcements at this time? Okay, now it's time to sit back, prepare our hearts and our minds for Christ Jesus as we listen to our prelude, "This Is My Father's World."
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin.
We are truly sorry and
humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us
our sins,
known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do.
Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit,
so that we may live and serve you in the newness of life. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Just do it. I'm already here. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, rich in mercy, by the humiliation of your Son, you lifted up this fallen world and rescued us from the hopelessness of death. Lead us into your light, that all our deeds may reflect your love, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
The first reading for today is from Numbers chapter 14, verses 4 through 9, or chapter 21, verses 4 through 9. A reading from Numbers. From Mount Hor, the Israelites set out by the way to the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom. But the people became impatient on the way. The people spoke out against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and we detest this miserable food. Then the Lord sent poisonous serpents among the people, and they bit the people, so that many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord to take away the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people, and the Lord said to Moses, "Make a poisonous serpent and set it on a pole, and everyone who has bitten shall look at it and live." So Moses made a serpent of bronze and put it upon a pole. And whenever a serpent bit someone, that person would look at the serpent of bronze and live. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm for today is Psalm 107. Please read in the bold print. Give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good, for God's mercy endures forever.
Let the redeemed of the Lord proclaim that God redeemed them from the hand of the foe.
Gathering them in from the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south.
Some were fools and took rebellious paths. Through their sins they were afflicted.
They loathed all manner of food and drew near to death's door. You sent forth your word and healed them, and rescued them from the grave.
Let them give thanks to you, Lord, for your steadfast love and your wonderful works for all people.
Let them offer sacrifices of thanksgiving and tell of your deeds with shouts of joy. Second reading from today is from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses. And we were by nature children of wrath, like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him at the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the results of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. And thanks to Augustus. And we have something a little bit, thank you, Augustus, a little bit different today. I hope you will get used to seeing this. It's my children's sermon basket. So will the children please come forward? Come on, guys. Oh, I'm so glad to see you. Oh, how am I going to do this? Oh, this is going to be very hard. Uh-huh. All right. Everybody, can everybody hear? And now in just a few moments, you guys are going to hear a story. Come on over here and be with me. A story about a group of people who were on a trip across the desert. We heard a little bit about it. It's not a nice trip. God is walking with them and helping them, but the people don't like everything God does for them. And they just want different things than God has given them. They want different food to eat, and they want something other than water to drink. Did you ever feel, Ma, I don't want water, I want... I love that. And you know what? Because they don't behave, you know what happens? But this won't happen to you. But you know what happens to them? God punishes them. And you know how God punishes them? He sends snakes to bite them. Isn't that terrible? I know. They're very serious biters. But listen to this. God loves them, so he sends a remedy, something that will take away the pain. And God says, all right, so sure you got bit by a snake, but if you look up at this, if you look up at this snake cross, the pain will go away. So those are serious bites, but this is serious medicine. Now, I have a snake cross for each of you to take home with you today. And it will save you from your troubles. But I want you to look around this room, and I want you to find another cross, a bigger cross. Look around. Oh, and where's a really, really big cross? Yeah. Look at that cross right there. See that big cross? That's the cross of Jesus. And there it is, and here we are. And every week we come here, and Jesus says, I am the new snake cross. You could have this one. You're getting two snake crosses? You have a lot of pain, right? So, the cross of Jesus saves us. But you can take these crosses home. I'm going to save this one with you. But remember, you have to look up at the cross. You know,
Mom, you're having a snake by your bed on Halloween.
God sent snakes. I just sent snake crosses. Now listen, can we pray together? Can we say a prayer together? All right, I'll say the beginning and then you repeat it, all right? You don't want the snake? You have to have the snake. They go together. All right, ready? Here's the prayer. Owen, are you ready? Say this after me. Dear Jesus. Say it out loud, Owen. Dear Jesus. Jesus. Thank you for the snakes.
Thank you for the snakes.
and thanks for loving me.
And Jesus, I love you too.
And thank you for the cross.
And
if you're really good during service, there's extra snacks in on right on Hannah's table that you can have after service. Okay? All right, go back to Mom and don't scare her. You got them all. I'm snakeless. Now I gotta get up. The Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said, "Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loves the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already because they have not believed in the name of the only Son. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Christ.
Please be seated and pray with me. Lord, you are our strength and our protection. When we feel down and out, you invite us in and you lift us up so we can get back to do what you have created us to do. Continue to lift us out of our fears and our frailty and our foolishness. Amen. Well, good morning, brothers and sisters. And we survived the first children's sermon. I survived. Well, welcome to worship on this fourth Sunday in Lent. And I hope all of you here today in our sanctuary and all of those who are watching from home, I hope that you can feel this strong sense of family that we have, that we're blessed with here at our Savior. And we get this same sense in John's Gospel. The members of John's community consider themselves family, just like we do. We are all children of God, and we love one another. And this love brings us joy and peace. So every week, we have a kind of family reunion here at Our Savior. We are called to be together here, and that is such a blessing. We are in the world, but every week, Jesus calls us out of the world and into this place of grace so that every week we can leave here with our hearts full of God's love. And every week we can share that love all week long. We are called out of this sanctuary to do special work, but not because we are special. Paul, in his letter to the Ephesians, makes that very clear. It is not our talents. It is God's love and mercy that equips us for this job, our job of doing good. We are called to do good works in the world, and that's what we're supposed to be doing more of during this Lenten season. Jesus counts on us to be who he has created us to be. For we are who he has made us. That has to be the most wonderful thing ever. Listen carefully to this. When we were dead, Christ made us alive again. Christ was raised up and raised us up with him. By grace, we are lifted up. And we are sealed with the Holy Spirit, not by magic and not by our own power, but by the power of the Spirit. We are saved by God's love, not by good works, but by grace. That is the good news, the essence of the gospel. And we are so thankful for that. And we heard that in our psalm today. We give thanks, for the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. He gathers us together from all the corners of the world, east and west. He saves us from wandering in the wilderness. When you get home, try to read that entire psalm, because it's so beautiful and it's so uplifting. And doesn't it seem that all of our readings today share the same theme, lifting up and being upright? And that's what we should be. That's who we are. We are upright, right? Well, that means that we are moral, honorable, obedient, scrupulous, blameless. Well, that's not us, right? We're not upright. And that's why God has to come and do the heavy lifting, because we can't lift ourselves up. We can't save ourselves. And we can hear that in all the readings today. And we have such good readings today. Couldn't we spend ages marveling at the fact that by grace we are saved? And couldn't we spend months and months in John's third chapter of his gospel marveling at how much God loves us? God so loves the world that he gave his only son, so that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. That verse is the most famous verse in the New Testament, and it's the most translated verse in the New Testament. And we've seen it everywhere, on Tim Tebow's cheeks during football games, and we see it on billboards and embroidered on throw pillows. And many of us carry that verse in our hearts like a priceless treasure. And all our readings today contain priceless, beautiful gems. Just listen. You are saved by grace alone, because God so loves the world, he gave his only son, so we could have eternal life. God, you are so good, and your steadfast love endures forever. These are beautiful, life-changing words that are written on our hearts. And doesn't it seem like we've known them and loved them forever? But how about verse 14 of John's gospel reading today? Listen to this verse. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. Now that verse is probably not as familiar to many of us. So let's go there now to the book of Numbers in the Torah, the Old Testament. And many of you know I love the Old Testament. And we gather here every Thursday at noon at Our Savior, and we read the Torah together. Now, I didn't pick this Old Testament story today to share with you. John did. And John put this story on the lips of Jesus. So let's look at the story, which is sometimes known as the story of the bronze serpent, or as I refer to it, the snake on a stake story, which I admit, sounds like something you would order at Chaz 21, right? Or Prime. Snake on a steak. Sort of sounds like an Ophidian kebab, right? Slices of snake on a skewer. It sounds awful. Well, if you don't know this story yet, get ready. Gird your loins, because it's a bit awful. But snake stories usually are awful. And this one is definitely not your garden variety snake story. Get it? Our snake story today does not take place in the Garden of Eden. We know about that snake. It got us out of that garden. But for our snake story today, we have to go back to about 1,300 years before Jesus was born. We have to go back to the days of Moses, leading the Israelites through the desert to the Promised Land. Now remember, first they got the promise of deliverance from slavery in Egypt. Then the sea parted, and they were delivered on to dry land. Really dry land, land with no resources. The desert. And they're walking through the desert, and it seems like forever. Now we've been walking through Lent, not an easy journey. For 40 days we walk through Lent toward the promise. Well, the Israelites walk for 40 years, and they feel trapped between the promise and the reality. God promised a land of milk and honey. Well, not only is there no milk and no honey, there's no good drinking water, and there's no shade. So they're always hot and thirsty, and there's no food. There's just manna. So what do? Well, they do what we do when we're uncomfortable. They complain, and they gripe, just like always, just like us. And of course, this is nothing new for them. The Israelites have been griping and complaining since they left Egypt, since the very start of the journey. And just so you know, this group is down to just Moses as their leader. Aaron and Miriam are dead. They were the brother and sister of Moses. They were co-leaders, but they're gone now, so Moses is leading alone. And when a local Canaanite king, a chieftain really, when he hears that Aaron and Miriam are dead and Moses is leading alone and the Israelites are vulnerable, he attacks. And things look bad for the Israelites. They're losing the battle until they call out to God, "Save us!" And God hears them and saves them, just like always, just like God saves us. And then they continue on their journey through the wilderness, where it's still hot and they are still thirsty, so they are still complaining, just like always, just like us. But this time, their complaints sound a bit different, more serious, because they actually speak out against Moses and against God. They actually revile what God has given them. They complained, "This isn't what we asked for. We didn't order this. We didn't sign up for this. Where's the milk? Where's the honey?" And they tell Moses, "Moses, you stink. And this whole place stinks. And this water is barely drinkable. And this bread, if you can call it bread, is wretched. We loathe it. It makes us wretch when we try to swallow it." Now, do you remember what this bread is? It's manna, God's gift of bread from heaven. It's the miracle bread, and the people reject this divine gift from God. And when our Father sees his people reject his gift of manna, he loses his temper, and he sends the people a lethal punishment. And now we know where Jesus got his temper. We just read that Jesus turns over the tables in the temple. Well, here the Father turns on his people, and he sends them viper serpents, seraph serpents. Seraph means burning, and the bites of these snakes burn. And they don't just burn, they kill. It's poisonous venom. So many of the people die right there in the wilderness. So why would God do this? But can't you just hear the people saying, "Who cares why?" They just want it to stop. So they go to Moses, and they tell Moses, "Do something. We messed up, just like always, just like us. We sinned. We spoke out against the Lord. Help us. Go to God on our behalf. Beg God to take the serpents away. So Moses asks, and God answers. And God tells Moses, make a mold of a serpent, pour hot bronze in the mold. Now put that molded snake on a pole, a standard, a stake, and put the snake on the stake and lift it up. Raise it up and tell everyone who has been bitten by the real poisonous snakes that I sent, if they look up at the raised serpent, they will be saved from the real serpent. They will recover. So they did. They looked up and they did recover. They were saved. God saved them, just like always, just like us. But how? How did looking at the fake snake save them from the bites of the real snakes? Well, just think. Looking up at that bronze snake reminded them of why they deserved to be punished. And that sounds right. That's step one for us to look up and remember why. Why you need repentance and forgiveness. And remember just how dangerous this journey is, and how much you need God's help, and how much you depend on God to get you through your wilderness. And that sounds good. It sounds right. So whatever happened to the real snake on the stake? Did it ever make it out of the wilderness? It sure did. That pole with the snake at the top made it all the way to Jerusalem. Joshua carried it through the wilderness when Moses died, and it ended up years later in the temple in Jerusalem, where it stayed as a symbol of healing for almost 300 years. But it's not there anymore. It was removed by the reformers, not our reformers, not Luther. The snake pole, the symbol of healing, was destroyed by King Hezekiah, who's the reforming king of Israel. He had that pole with the snake destroyed because the people were venerating it, worshiping it, rather than worshiping the one who sent it. So this is a good story, right? Lots of lessons for us, not easy ones. But did you see yourself in the wilderness? Did you hear yourself gripe and complain? Now, I don't know about you, but I hate snakes. I think most people do. I think it's in our DNA. So why would God send snakes to teach us what we need to know? Well, just think. God didn't send them. The snakes were already there, and they're already here. Our world, our wilderness, is filled with all kinds of dangerous serpents. And we know God uses what is available, even if it's scary and dangerous. God uses it for good, always for good, our good. And that's the story of the snake on a stake. And it's the same story that we hear when we come here and we look up at Christ's cross. All that brutality, all that pain, God uses all that for good, our own good. By this cross, we are healed. We are saved. We know we are loved. So will we share all this good with all God's children? Will we lift up Christ's cross and proclaim the love of God? And all God's children say, amen.
Lift high the cross, the love of God proclaim, till all the world adore His sacred name. Thank you.
was lifted on the glorious tree. Stand as we confess that faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit. Trusting in God's promise to reconcile all things, let us pray for the church, the well-being of creation, and a world in need. Gracious God, your love unites. Give vision to the global church and foster cooperation in mission. Increase interreligious understanding and ecumenical dialogue. Make your church a sanctuary for all who are fleeing persecution, disaster, and war. Hear us, O God. Creating God, your love enlivens. Restore balance to the earth's fragile habitats. Preserve wilderness lands, rainforests, and wildlife. Cleanse oceans and rivers. Make us good stewards of the earth. Hear us, O God. Righteous God, your love liberates. We give thanks for those who courageously witness to your liberated love. Free all people from the evils of racism, religious strife, and hatred. Hear us, O God. Merciful God, your love heals. Care tenderly for all whose loved ones perished from pandemic disease in every nation. Strengthen health care workers, first responders, and caregivers. Relieve all who live with chronic illness and pain. And we offer prayers for all those who are listed in our bulletin and in the messenger, and all those who we hold in our hearts, and those who we now name aloud in your presence. Hear us, O God. Incarnate God, your love enlightens. Open our hearts and minds to fresh understandings of our faith. Deepen our love for you and for one another. Teach us to pray for our enemies. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Abiding God, your love saves. Those who died in the faith are made alive in Christ. We give thanks for your promise that we also will be raised to newness of life. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Accompany us on our journey, God of grace, and receive the prayers of our hearts. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you all, always.
And also with you.
Let us share God's peace with one another. all the snakes out. He took all the snakes. Peace be with you. God's peace.
No more snakes.
Uh-oh. God's peace. God's peace be with you. God's peace. God's peace. God's peace be with you. God's peace be with you. God's peace. God's peace. God's peace be with you. God's peace be with you. God's peace be with you. Owen, where's the snakes? Oh, you got them. Our provider, you have not fed us with bread alone, but with words of grace and life. Bless us in these gifts which we receive from your bounty through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that, renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and he gave thanks, and he gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Now, gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Please be seated, and please join Barb and Norm in singing Lamb of God. We all know it, and we all love it, and we will all see it next week in the bulletin. But now, let's sing it from our hearts.
This is the body.
given and shed for you. This is the body and the blood of Christ given and shed for you. This is the body and the blood of Christ given and shed for you. This is the body and the blood of Christ given and shed for you. Chuck, this is the body and the blood of Christ given and shed for you. This is the body and the blood of Christ given and shed for you. This is the body and the blood of Christ given and shed for you. This is the body and the blood of Christ given and shed for you. This is the body and the blood of Christ given and shed for you. This is the body and the blood of Christ given and shed for you. This is the body and the blood of Christ given and shed for you. This is the body and the blood of Christ given and shed for you. This is the body and the blood of Christ given and shed for you. Please stand and let us pray. Compassionate God, you have fed us with the bread of heaven. Sustain us in our Lenten pilgrimage. May our fasting be hunger for justice, our alms a making of peace, and our prayer the song of grateful hearts through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Now receive the blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen. Amen.